In 1930, the Republican-controlled House of Representatives, in an effort to alleviate the effects of the... Anyone? Anyone? The Great Depression, passed the... Anyone? Anyone? A tariff bill, the Hawley-Smoot Tariff Act, which... Anyone raised or lowered? Raised tariffs in an effort to collect more revenue for the federal government. Did it work? Anyone? Anyone know the effects? It did not work, and the United States sank deeper into the Great Depression. Today, we have a similar debate over this. Anyone know what this is, class? Anyone? Anyone? Anyone seen this before? The Laffer Curve. Anyone know what this says? It says that at this point on the revenue curve, you will get exactly the same amount of revenue as at this point. This is very controversial. Does anyone know what Vice President Bush called this in 1980? Anyone? Something D-O-O economics.
And you are now in the very sweetest spot of investment banking, with, at least many of you are in private equity. I am so happy to see that the face of private equity, the face of the deals that you guys make, is now like the face of America. It is a wonderful, wonderful thing. I keep thinking to myself, when my sister got out of Wellesley College in 1963, Phi Beta Kappa, and wanted to work in finance, and they told her the highest she could ever aspire to be was executive secretary at Goldman Sachs. And that world has changed incredibly. I am so grateful to see it. I had a friend at Columbia, you and I may remember him, a guy named Hilton Clark, who was a very, very smart black man who went in to have an interview at an investment bank. He had a very fancy name. They didn't know he was a black man, and he went in there. And literally, they asked him who was there for the job of shoe shiner, because they would have a guy come through shining shoes of the partners every morning. And what an incredible, unbelievable miracle has been wrought in America. How great a change there has been. It makes me think of something. I had lunch with my sister yesterday in New York. And I live in L.A., but I was in New York, and I had lunch with her. And she's an exercise fanatic. And she called me up this morning, and she said to me, "Now, Benji, I know that this hotel that you're in has really great exercise facilities. What exercise have you done this morning?" I myself, she added modestly, have been on the treadmill for an hour and on the Stairmaster for 25 minutes. What did you do this morning? And I said, "Rachel, I'll tell you what. Here's the exercise I did this morning. I got out of bed and I got on my knees and I thanked God for waking up in America, and that's plenty of exercise for me." And I carry that attitude of gratitude with me all through the day. And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, before I get into the body of my speech, I know that it's been now over a month since the Academy Awards, but I am still really doing a slow burn about that. The Academy Awards lasted about 3.5 hours, about 3 hours and 20 minutes too long, and I noticed that it went on, and they congratulated themselves for being brave enough to stand up to the oil companies. That's really brave in Hollywood. They congratulated themselves on being brave enough to stand up to Senator Joe McCarthy 50 years after he's dead and his body is lying in the Senate Rotunda. And I thought to myself, you guys are on for 3.5 hours congratulating yourself on being millionaires and having the courage to sit at a computer and write screenplays and get paid millions of dollars for it. How about one freaking word of gratitude to the men and women wearing the uniform in Baghdad and Ar-Ramadi and Kirkuk and Mosul? How about just one word for those guys? How about just one word for the guys who go in there when the IEDs are exploding and the bullets are flying and they don't have stunt doubles to go in for them? Just one word. Well, I must say, I apologize for bringing up my own anger about it, but I am sick about it. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I know that there are many, many successful people in this room. You're in private equity. How could you miss? But I know that probably all of you together are not as rich as the King of Saudi Arabia. And the King of Saudi Arabia has many children, And don't stop me if you've heard this before. But his favorite is a boy named Hassan, who's about to turn 12 years old. He says to him, Hassan, now you're about to turn 12 years old. I would like you and your friends to have a birthday party that you'll never forget. So I want you to assemble your 25 closest friends at the palace in Riyadh, and we're going to have a party the likes of which you have never seen before. So the kid assembles his friends, and the next morning they leave in a fleet of Rolls-Royce limousines for the Riyadh airport. And there they board a specially outfitted Boeing 777, the pride of the Boeing fleet, a magnificent plane. It's been specially reconfigured so that each kid has his own wireless internet connections at his seat. Each kid can play EverQuest and Counter-Strike as they fly across the Mediterranean and then fly across the Atlantic. They can play bouncy cannon off the fuselage wall. They can have any kind of food they want. Each kid has his own steward. They're having a great, great time. King says to his son, Son, how do you like this specially outfitted Boeing 777? Kid says, Dad, I love it. King says, yes, but do you really like it? And the kid says, Dad, we have Gulfstreams, we have Bombardiers, we have Canadair Challengers, we have every kind of plane in the kingdom, but this is the best plane I've ever been on. I love this plane. King says, great.
Wait, I'll do that better. I'll do that better. I can't do it better.
He says, great, I bought it for you. So the kid says, wow, thanks, Dad. And the kid is in ecstasy, and he's in shock, but he's happy. So then they fly on to New York. They refuel at JFK. They fly on to LAX. Fleet of Cadillac limousines takes them up to the Beverly Hills Hotel. They have the whole hotel. The king is taking over the whole hotel. Each kid has a suite with his own room service attendant. Each kid can play internet games all night long. They can hit tennis balls out into Sunset Boulevard and snarl up traffic for hours. Kids are having a great time. King says to his son, Son, how do you like the Beverly Hills Hotel? Kid says, Dad, I love it. King says, yes, but do you really like it? The kid says, Dad, I love it. King says, great, I bought it. That's what I meant to do. The king says, great, I bought it for you. So the kid is in shock, but he's happy. Next day, a fleet of Bentley limousines takes the kids down to Disneyland. King has taken over all of Disneyland, every bit of it. There's no other guests there except the kid, his 25 closest friends, their bodyguards, and the king. The kids can ride on any ride they want. There's no limit on their rides. And one kid can ride Space Mountain or the Pirates of the Caribbean. They're having an incredibly great time. King says to his son, Son, how do you like Disneyland? Kid says, Dad, I love it. Now, I know ours is the sacred kingdom of Allah, but this is truly the enchanted kingdom, the happiest place on earth, and I love it. King says, yes, but do you really like it? The kid says, wait, Dad, please do not buy me Disneyland. I know you're a wonderful dad, and I appreciate it. So do the people at ExxonMobil, but I really, really, really do not want you to buy me Disneyland. You've already bought me so much stuff. You bought me a Boeing jetliner. You've bought me the Beverly Hills Hotel. Please don't buy me any more stuff. And the king says, but it's your birthday. Today is your exact birthday. I want to buy you something very special. Kid says, all right, if you want to buy me something very special, because we're at Disneyland, just buy me a dinky little Mickey Mouse outfit, and I'll be totally happy. Just a little dinky Mickey Mouse outfit. That'll make my day. So the king bought him the American Trial Lawyers Association. Anyway.